accepting for William Langford and his family. We have, and you've already seen him on the TV, maybe the foremost expert on Langford golf course architecture, my friend Dan Moore. Dan? This is the member one. This is the real McCoy.
Thank you, Tim, and thank you to the Illinois Golf Hall of Fame for all your efforts on behalf of all of us crazy enthusiastic golfers here in Illinois. Thank you, Executive Director Carrie Williams, and Palmer Moody, and the rest of the staff here for putting on a wonderful event tonight. And congratulations to all the other nominees. I'm sure Mr. Langford would be honored tonight to be in your company. Tonight, I'm going to speak on behalf of my fellow co-nominator, Josh Lesnick, you saw on the screen a second ago, and William Langford's family, and my many friends in golf architecture, my many friends who are members of Langford courses around Chicago and the Midwest. Many of them are very excited that Mr. Langford's receiving this honor tonight, and so thank you. His granddaughter, Liz, and family as well. They would have loved to be here tonight, but unfortunately had some longstanding business commitments that prevented them from being here. She sends her sincere thanks and gratitude to the Illinois Golf Hall of Fame for the recognition being bestowed tonight on her grandfather. So unless you're a golf architecture aficionado, or as I like to say, a golf architecture geek like myself, you may be asking, who was William Langford, and why is he being inducted into the Golf Hall of Fame tonight? The short answer is that he lived his entire life in the world of golf. His life was defined by golf and his relationship to it. I'd like to briefly take a closer look at his life and some of his accomplishments in golf. He was born, as the video said, in 1887 in the Austin neighborhood, west side of Chicago today. Near Oak Park. A 1961 article about Mr. Langford described why he took up golf. The article said, "Few people who know Bill are aware that he was stricken with polio as a child. By sheer willpower as a kid, and with the help and encouragement of his father and mother, both ardent golfers themselves, he dragged and stumbled around the course until his legs were brought back to usefulness." Usefulness indeed. He learned to play golf at Western Ho, a course near the family home. It was in Galewood, which is now Oak Park. He was taught by their professional, David McIntosh, who became here from St. Andrews, Scotland. McIntosh and Langford became lifelong friends, living together at Glen Oak and at times in the family home on Central Avenue. Under McIntosh's expert tutelage, Langford became a very accomplished golfer himself. He won three NCAA championships as a member of the Yale golf team. He twice won the Columbia University championship. He competed in a large number of U.S. and Western amateurs, and was a three-time winner of the Lake Worth tournament in Florida, which attracted a prestigious national field of amateurs. He continued playing golf his entire life, well into his 80s. Here are two of my favorite anecdotes about his playing career. In 1941, he and his mother carted a 78 in a mixed foursome two-ball event held at Mid-City. 78, not a bad score, you say. Really not bad, considering it was his mom's 78th birthday. I said he continued to play golf his entire life. Well, he did. In 1975, a few years short of his death in 1977 at age 89, 2 years before that, it was reported in the Tampa Tribune that he had scored an ace with a wedge on the 17th hole of the par 54 Loch Raven golf course in Tampa. As a golfer, he wasn't a long driver. A 1931 article recorded his drives were just 210 yards long. Rather, his game relied on control, accurate approaching, and a very strong short game. Characteristics he would be sure to test and reward in his strategic approach to golf course design. After earning his Yale letter in golf, you saw the picture of him with his letter sweater on there, and degrees in engineering at Yale and Columbia Universities. He worked for 2 years in the mines of West Virginia and Pennsylvania. Wisely, he decided he'd rather spend time in the sunshine and decided to pursue his love of golf as a golf course architect. In October 1914, he took out an ad in Golfer's Magazine at just the age of 27. It read, "William B. Langford, civil engineer, golf course architect, the design and construction of golf and country club grounds." He listed his business address as the family home at 621 North Central Avenue, Austin Station, Chicago. Working probably from the parlor or the dining room of the family home, he launched his business with the series of articles Tim mentioned in the video. They combined them into a pamphlet called Golf Course Architecture in the Chicago District, a very fitting title if you ask me, considering he was Chicago's very first homegrown golf course architect. He secured his first job in 1915 when he was hired by the Winnetka Park District, laying out 9 holes for what is today the Skokie Playfield Course, which he extended to 18 holes in 1919. In an amazing bit of historic synchronicity, he completed the circle of his 45-year-plus golf design career in 1961 when he completed his last Chicago design, the 9-hole course for the Winnetka Skokie Playfield Park District. His business expanded slowly from the family home in the war years of World War I, but by 1919, 100 years ago now, his business, architecture business was thriving. By then, he had designed an 18-hole course for the Riverside Golf Club, a new 18-hole course for Ridge Golf Club here in Chicago, and was thoroughly updating and modernizing courses at Park Ridge, LaGrange Country Club, and Ridgemore, while adding a new 9th hole at Indian Hill, and greens and bunkers at Westmoreland Country Club. He was also busy throughout the rest of the Midwest. Around this time, he joined forces with his partner, Theodore Moreau, to form the firm of Langford & Moreau, based out of the Marquette Building in downtown Chicago. The 1920s, the Roaring Twenties, would bring a golf boom to the Chicago area. For Langford, that meant Bryn Mawr Country Club, 27 holes at Butterfield, 27 holes for a country club that is now the Schaumburg Municipal Course, a course called Twin Orchard in its original location, which is now O'Hare Field, Acacia, Ruth Lake in the Chicago area, and numerous courses dotted throughout the Midwest, ranging from South Dakota, Kansas, Iowa, Missouri, Minnesota, Michigan, Indiana, Ohio, Tennessee, Kentucky, and Arkansas. He traveled quite a bit. 2 of those, Wakanda and Des Moines, and Blythefield Country Club in Grand Rapids, hosted Champions Tour and LPGA events just this year. In 1921, they opened a winter office in Lake Worth, Florida. We all like to get away from Chicago in winter, don't we? This would lead to dozens of courses in Florida, including a couple of their most unique designs. In Key West, he carved out from the coral reefs of Stock Island a golf course that was they blasted away and built a course there. The Country Club of Chicago at Valparaiso was built in the sand barrens of the Florida Panhandle. And at Lake Worth, he built a course which was a favorite of Babe Ruth back in the day, which he built by dredging out Lake Worth for sand and built a course on the shore of the lake between Palm Beach and the Atlantic Causeway. What made his architecture was unique was they were among the first golf architectural firms to offer a turnkey design and build and design and build operation, which combined the latest innovations in strategic golf course design and construction techniques. His profound appreciation of strategic golf resulted in an artistic melding of natural and constructed golf course features. Langford and Moreau were among the most prolific golf course design and construction firms in the United States in the 1920s, exceeded probably only by Donald Ross and Associates. Rather than try to describe his architecture and courses, I thought it'd be insightful and a little bit fun to hear directly from Mr. Langford himself. Here are a few quotes from various writings of Mr. Langford that illustrate his thinking about golf course design and the role of the golf course architect. So these next will be a few quotes. "No golf course can be properly developed to function as it should unless the designer appreciates the complicated relationships between the course, the mechanics and strategy of the game, and the player's psychological reactions. A good designer should use nature, not mutilate it. The well-designed hole should require a player to think before they shoot. The real measure of a hole's character and difficulty is the variations and scores made on it. Today, the development of elective avenues of play has been subordinated to distance, which has been greatly overemphasized in a game where accuracy, versatility, and judgment should be paramount. The thoughtless method used by many greens committees and some architects is to make course a championship layout is to increase its length. The scoring ability of each golfer is based on different skills. Courses must test all of these abilities equally to sift out the best all-around players in any competitive field. In this game, most anything can happen. It is the architect's task to see that it is very apt to, especially to the Titans. Hazard should not be solely for the idea of penalizing bad play, but with the object of encouraging thoughtful golf and of rewarding the player who possesses the ability to play a variety of shots with each club. He was a master greens designer, so I just thought I'd throw in a couple more about greens and his thoughts on green construction. Warp on a green, I love that term, warp. Warp on a green not only increases short game interest, it also influences the stroke played to the green and plays a vital part in surface drainage, which must be perfect to assure satisfactory putting carpet. Instead of one long slope on a green, there are interweaving slopes. Complicated putting problems are presented, which the true golf student will relish. These ideas are on full display today at many of his courses, especially the Lasonia Links. A lot of the drone footage in the video is of Lasonia. That course is generally considered their masterpiece, and I encourage all of you to get up there and take a look. Lasonia was built with their biggest budget to that date, $250,000, quite a bit of money in those days. It opened in 1930, just as the Great Depression was bringing the golf design business to a screeching halt until after World War II. Langford was just 43 years old at the time. Imagine what other courses he might have designed over the next 15 years. Langford survived the depression-induced crash of the architecture business through his second major component of his life in golf as the owner and operator of Daily Fee courses. As their careers were booming in the roaring 20s, Langford and Moreau opened Mid-City Golf Course on July 4, 1924, near Chicago's famous Riverview Park, bordered by Addison and Western and the Chicago River. Langford built the clubhouse on Gray Street with a large wing dedicated to his golf course design studio. The course was built over an old clay pit that had provided material for so many Chicago bungalows. As the clay ran out, the 30-foot deep pit, covering several miles around, became a dumping ground for construction, household, and other waste. As Langford described it, everybody thought we were nuts. Who ever heard of growing grass over a surface of wrecked automobiles, broken glass, concrete slabs, and cinders? But they advertised for free dumping to finish filling the pit. And he said, then we got some subsoil, some fair topsoil, or some ordinary dirt, and soon we had an earthy surface, and we built our course. He would operate Mid-City for 28 years, which no doubt helped him weather the 1930s, following the total collapse of the golf course design business. As development encroached on the course, it finally closed on September 30th, 1952. That day, David Condon, the great writer for the Chicago Tribune, wrote a poignant article on the closing, memorializing Bill Langford's final day at Mid-City. He wrote, Bill Langford this afternoon will play the Mid-City Golf Club's 18 holes for approximately the 2,000th time since the sporty layout was opened in 1924. Bill will then stow away the clubs, take a nostalgic last look, and drag out the close sign that will mark the passing of one of Chicago's most popular year-round courses. Condon went on to quote Mr. Langford, after George Harrington, Ross Kidston, and myself finished the farewell tour, and when the last player has checked in and had his drink, Mid-City will be a thing of the past. In addition to Mid-City, Langford operated the Langford Links course in Bensonville, the former Twin Orchard Golf Club. He operated that on a daily fee basis until it was plowed under for the runways of O'Hare Field. And in the 1950s ran Gledwoody Golf Course, which may explain why it has some of the best greens of any public course in the Chicago area. In addition to his role as an owner-operator of Daily Fee courses, he also served on the Chicago Daily Fee Golf Association, along with people like Bert Coghill and Joe Roseman and others, where he chaired their annual tournament committee and served for many years on the USGA Public Links Committee, where he advocated for expansion of tournament opportunities for the Daily Fee public golfer. Public golfers today can continue to enjoy Langford designs at Schaumburg Golf Club, Winnetka Golf Club, Skokie Playfield, Kankakee Elks, Spring Valley Golf Club just over the Wisconsin border, 9 holes at Harrison Hills Golf Club in Indiana, and at Langford and Moreau's best course, the Lasonia Links in Green Lake. According to Liz Hootman, Langford's granddaughter, supporting public golf and the Daily Fee golfer was her grandfather's proudest achievement in golf. I'd like to wrap up with a few comments about Mr. Langford's legacy and impact. As was noted there, he developed a concept of rating courses that helped influence and lead to today's handicap system that allows all of us to play against each other, even if we have different abilities. Along with Donald Ross, Stanley Thompson, and Robert Trent Jones, he founded the American Society of Golf Course Architects to advocate for his fellow golf architects. He was so respected by his peers that they twice elected him to serve as president. The late great Chicago architect Larry Packard, who once worked for Mr. Langford, thought his designs were excellent. "I tried to copy him as much as I could," he said. "He was starting to slow down then, so I used to go over at night and help him with his drawings. When we got tired, we'd go out in the backyard and play croquet." Mr. Langford was also a major influence on today's great master, Pete Dye. As Golf Digest architecture editor Ron Witten tells the story, "Pete was always raving about these wonderful Seth Rayner courses, but when I went to see them, they were all Langfords: Harrison Hills, Culver Academy, West Bend, and Wisconsin." And his wife, Alice Dye, grew up on a Langford course, Max and Tucky in Indiana. She said, "We thought his work was terrific, some of the best architecture we've ever seen. So we copied one of his greens for the 12th green at Crooked Stick. It's a copy of the 5th at Max and Tucky in Culver." To conclude, I'd like to read a brief commentary from Mr. Langford from late in his golf life on the promotion of sportsmanship and the role of the golf professional. This is from a 1961 article, which I've edited a little bit for brevity and flow. The article started, "Bill has a philosophy of golf that hundreds of professionals say explain the appeal of the game by men of goodwill, the true sportsmen. Of sportsmanship, he says, games and athletics, being builders of body and character, exert a strong influence on many phases of human relations. Sportsmanship is the heritage of medieval chivalry, which contributed so much in the world's climb from the brutality of the Dark Ages. Certainly, a strict observance of the rules and an honest appreciation of an opponent's worth create an atmosphere unfavorable to intolerance, greed, or foul play. Based on courage and generosity, sportsmanship flourishes because it appeals to the highest ideals of man. It is not the property of any social group or of any race. It is universal. If we observe its teachings, the misunderstanding and suspicion, which usually wrecks coalitions of peoples of different languages, religions, and customs, will evaporate, especially if our efforts to spread this philosophy is directed to the young, who are the idealists and will soon be adult members of our team. The professional, functioning properly as a performer or as an instructor, is an instrument of inestimable value. As the spirit of sportsmanship is kindled in contest and spread by example and emulation, professionalism's best service is the development of the skill and ethics of amateurs." And finally, I'd just like to pass on a few words from Mr. Langford's granddaughter, Liz Hootman. She said, "We're thrilled and speechless that Grandpa has been inducted into the Illinois Golf Hall of Fame. I have happy memories of him, including his monthly phone calls from Chick Evans, stories about living at Glen Oak Country Club with David McIntosh, and teaching all of us the game of golf. He was a cheery, fun, intelligent man. He was always happy singing his Yale fight songs. Thank you again for this honor. Grandpa, or Willie as he was known to his family, would be so appreciative." Thank you again.